morning. Can you read the slide?
Yes, ma'am.
So read it and try to follow it. Is it not? So all of us have to grab whatever opportunities we get in our life. Because the things are going to happen. The chances you will get are only once. So don't miss whatever you are getting and don't regret for whatever you lost. Always we have to look forward for the good things, or try to grab whatever you get from that, what is good from that opportunity or situation. We should start to grab it. Okay, so with this quote or we will start with a fresh morning. I am going to continue with the remaining aspects of this vitamins, water soluble vitamins, what I was discussing in the previous classes. So hope you are able to get what we are telling. Anyway, so under this, now so far we have completed many amino acids like B1, B2, B3, B5, 6. Then I have already finished vitamin B9 and B12 in the list of the vitamin, water soluble vitamin. So you have to recall all those things. And now today I am going to discuss about the remaining aspects of this water soluble vitamins under the energy generating another group, that is vitamin C. I am going to deal in the next lecture. That will be the concluding lecture for water soluble vitamins. So today these are the small aspects that are remaining about the water soluble vitamins. So in that we will be understanding about biotin today. So today we will be understanding about biotin. So this biotin also, it is called as vitamin H, or it is the coenzyme R, anti-egg white injury factor. So most commonly it is known as anti-egg white injury factor. All of us have to remember this important point related to biotin. So biotin is an anti-egg white injury factor, or vitamin H. This is also called as. Now why it is called so, what is the purpose or importance of this vitamin, that we will be understanding in the further slides. So this biotin is a chemically heterocyclic monocarboxylic acid. It is a sulfur containing water soluble vitamin B. It was structure was elucidated by the scientist Du Weinenkorn, for which he grabbed the Nobel Prize. And this has got an imidazole ring which is fused with a thiophene ring with sulfur. So you can see the chemical structure here. There are two heterocyclic rings here. This is a heterocyclic ring containing sulfur, then to which there is a single carboxylic acid added. So it is a monocarboxylic heterocyclic sulfur containing water soluble acid. Now the carboxylic group of this biotin forms an amide linkage with the lysine residue, epsilon nitrogen of the lysine residue. So if you remember the structure of lysine, it is containing number of carbon atoms, and in that epsilon residue, lysine residue, nitrogen is going to be linked for the formation of a coenzyme. So this coenzyme will be linking with the apoenzyme, and that is going to form biocytin, and in the form of biocytin it is going to exhibit its coenzyme role. So that is the important point related to biotin. So it links with the apoenzyme with the help of nitrogen, epsilon nitrogen in the lysine residue of that molecule. This is the chemical part of this biotin. This is required around 100 to 300 microgram per day. Normal bacterial flora of the gut provides adequate quantities of biotin, and as it is distributed ubiquitously in and plant tissues. As such, biotin deficiency is rare, but it has got some manifestations. So plant sources we can have legumes, grains, tomatoes, carrots. Animal sources, liver, yeast, milk, egg, yolk are the rich sources. Now coming to its coenzyme form or biochemical role. So this biotin, once it is absorbed, will be always in the form of biocyanidin, that is biotinyl 5' adenylate. So you have to remember biocyanidin only. So after absorption, it is in the form of biocyanidin. Now that biocyanidin is always linked with the apoenzyme through epsilon nitrogen of lysine residue, that we have to keep in mind. Then, and the important role of this biocyanidin is as a coenzyme for the metabolisms of all the three major biomolecules, that is all the three molecules, fat, protein and carbohydrate. Basically, this helps in the decarboxylation reaction and it serves as a carrier for carbon dioxide in the decarboxylation reaction. So in the diagram you can see here how biocyanidin will be exhibiting its coenzyme role can be given with this diagram. So it helps in the carboxylation reaction. Now this is your biocyanidin. When it is getting involved in the decarboxylation reactions, what it does, it takes the CO2 and then in presence of ATP, it will be converted in an intermediate that is called as carbonic phosphoric anhydride. And this is through this intermediate, it is converted into with the loss of one phosphate, inorganic phosphate, it will be converted into carboxybiotin enzyme. So it takes up the CO2, that is by the decarboxylation which is being taken from the one substrate, then this CO2 attached to this biotin will be taken up by carboxybiotin. This is given to the substrate and you will ultimately get the carboxylated substrate. So this, its major role is in the decarboxylation reactions. So it should be carboxylation reaction. It is in the carboxylation, you have to remember. So the enzymes, just to make a correction here, it should be carboxylation. Here also it is correct written carboxylation only. So it adds carbon dioxide to the substrate and you will get the carboxylated substrate. So this carboxylase is the enzyme complex which is going to have this biotin as its integral part. So carboxylase is a multi-enzyme complex containing three components on one polypeptide chain. So multi-enzyme complex comprises biotin carboxyl carrier protein, biotin carboxylase and a transcarboxylase. So always remember the carboxylases have got three components. One is biotinyl carboxyl carrier protein, biotin carboxylase and a transcarboxylase. So these are the things that are going to be present as a part of this carboxylase enzyme. I will make correction here. So the holocarboxylase enzyme is required for the attachment of biotin to apoenzyme. So these are the components of the any carboxylase enzyme system. Major carboxylation reaction that are taking place inside the body has got the biotin as the coenzyme. The important carboxylases can be summarized as below. So biotin requiring carboxylation reactions in the metabolism are, one enzyme that you have to remember is acetyl-CoA carboxylase. Now what this does, this is a rate limiting reaction in the biosynthesis of fatty acid. So to summarize the role of biotin as a coenzyme, these acetyl CoA carboxylase we can quote here. So acetyl CoA, this reaction goes like this. Acetyl CoA takes up carbon dioxide in presence of ATP, and it will be converted by the enzyme acetyl CoA carboxylase to malonyl CoA, and ATP and PI are released free. Same way, propionyl CoA is converted into methyl malonyl CoA with the help of propionyl CoA carboxylase. The another important reaction, pyruvate carboxylase, for the conversion of pyruvate to oxaloacetate. Now these will be given for the TCA and gluconeogenesis. Oxaloacetate can be used. Next is beta methyl protonyl CoA carboxylase will be converted into beta methyl glucanyl CoA. So all these carboxylation reactions are dependent on biotin, that you have to remember. Next, there are some other reactions also which are same carboxylation only, but they are not dependent on biotin. So they are CPS, carbamoyl phosphate synthetase. That is, you have two CPSs, CPS1 and CPS2, one in the purine metabolism, the other one is in the urea cycle, that you are going to learn. So CPS1 and 2 are the two examples of carbamoyl phosphate synthetases, one in nucleic acid metabolism, the other in urea cycle. Next is addition of CO2 to form C6 in the purine ring. So nucleotide metabolism, again formation of the purine ring, and the malic enzyme which converts pyruvate to malate. So these are also the examples of carboxylation reactions, but they are not dependent on biotin. So you can remember the role of biotin by the names carboxylases. So these reactions will be dependent on biotin, because whenever you are writing about any enzyme, you have to mention their biochemical functions with giving the proper specific reactions where these enzyme acts as a coenzyme. So these synthetases and other malic enzyme, they do not require biotin as a coenzyme. Apart from this, nowadays, recently the research has found that this biotin has got the role in the regulation of cell cycle. These are the recent advances or additions in the study of biotin. That is, it helps in the regulation of cell cycle. And normal progression of cell goes, all of us know that it goes through the cell cycle. And this biotin deficiency, if there is no sufficient amount of biotin, it is going to affect the G1 phase of the cell cycle. That is the recent other biochemical function of biotin recently added. So latest textbooks have got these biochemical functions, whereas you will not find this in the earlier textbooks. So latest editions of the biochemistry textbooks, we have all these other biochemical functions. Next is the regulator. It acts as a regulator of gene expression, and it is mainly involved in the expression of the genes for the formation of P450 and oncogenes, cytokines and all other receptors. Biotin is normally necessary for the normal growth of hair and nails. So I think you might have come across the certain advertisements of the cosmetics or the products or hair care products, especially shampoos, next conditioners and hair oils, where you might have seen the addition of biotin and all these things in the advertisement of these cosmetic hair products. So it is mainly because of its role in normal growth of hair and neck. Now coming to why it is called so, as an anti-egg white injury factor. Now here we have to understand about the protein that is called as avidin. Now this avidin is a protein which is present in egg white. So if we have to, there are two components in the egg, raw egg. One is egg yolk and egg white. So white is nothing but the egg albumin. So this egg white component has got this avidin is containing in that, and it has a great affinity to biotin. Hence, intake of raw egg may cause biotin deficiency. So this protein epidin has got biotin affinity. So what happens? It is going to affect this deficiency of biotin if you consume continuously the raw eggs. But on boiling, what happens? As it is heat labile, this avidin is lost or neutralized. So avidin is a heat labile protein, and boiling of egg will neutralize the inhibitory activity of this biotin. So avidin, if you consume raw eggs, will lead to the deficiency of biotin because it has got more affinity towards biotin, this avidin. But on boiling, this avidin is neutralized, or you can say it is destroyed, and hence it will affect, it will not lead to biotin deficiency. And hence we have to see that you can take raw eggs, but in the adequate quantities. If you consume continuously raw eggs, it is going to lead to biotin deficiency, and that is the main reason for biotin deficiency seen in them who are consuming the raw eggs. So better, once you boil it, then avidin will be lost and it will neutralize the inhibitory effect of biotin, binding to avidin, and that is why this has to be boiled. Egg white contains avidin and egg yolk has got the biotin. So avidin biotin system is commonly nowadays utilized in the research purpose for the detection of pathogens in enzyme linked immunosorbent assay, that is ELISA test. So this is nowadays, it has got role in the ELISA test. So this is all about avidin. So you should remember about avidin. And now, to prevent this injury caused due to egg white, that is biotin deficiency, when the supplements of biotin were given to the patients, it was seen that they were recovered, and that is why it is called as anti-egg white injury factor. What we have seen the first slide, if you can recall the name of this vitamin, anti-egg white injury factor, it is because the deficiency of biotin, which is caused in the people who are consuming raw egg due to avidin protein present in the egg white part, that can be treated or overcome by taking biotin, and that is why it is called as anti-egg white injury factor. I hope you have understood this. Nowadays, it has got applications in the DNA radio labeling also. This recently, biotin labeling of DNA is becoming more popular. Biotin is added to nucleotides, which will be incorporated into the newly synthesized DNA. The fixed biotin can be identified by the reaction with biotin versus streptavidin purified form from streptomyces avidini, and that can bind with the four molecules of biotin. So nowadays, the research in the laboratory is utilizing this biotin for different techniques. One is ELISA, the second is biotin labeling of the DNA that will be added for the research purposes. So these are the applications. One thing is about avidin, the second thing about the application of this biotin in labs. So next, coming to its deficiency, only it is seen during the prolonged use of antibacterial drugs as well as those who are consuming the raw eggs. So the symptoms include dermatitis, atrophic glossitis, hyperesthesia, muscle pain, anorexia, and hallucination. Deficiency of the biotin is manifestation is splitting of the nails. So you can see such type of splitting of the nails if you see in patients, it may be because of biotin. And therapeutically, it can be used in the dosage of 100 to 300 milligram of IV injections will bring about the rapid cure of these symptoms. So this is about this small but important amino sorry vitamin biotin that is involved in carboxylation reactions. All the important carboxylases you have to remember: acetyl CoA, propionyl CoA, and pyruvate carboxylase. Methyl malonyl CoA carboxylase. So these are the four important carboxylation reactions which are dependent on biotin. There are the examples of non-biotin dependent carboxylations. You can recall that is involved in this purine ring formation. Next is the two reactions catalyzed by CPS, that is CPS 1 and CPS 2. So these are the important points related to biotin. And then you have to remember about the protein avidin. What do you mean by anti-egg white injury, and why this protein is called as vitamin is called as anti-egg white injury factor. So this is all about biotin and its role in the body. Now we are going to understand about a group of certain organic compounds. They are related to vitamins in activity but cannot be called as true vitamins, but they are nutritionally found to be important, and then normally they can be synthesized by the humans in adequate amounts, and therefore they are not required in the diet. So here is a group of vitamin like substances that we are trying to understand now. So these substances are usually classified with B complex vitamins because of similarities in biochemical functions or distribution of them in the foods. Understood? So you have heard of these compounds: choline, lipoic acid, inositol, and PABA. So these are called as the vitamin-like substances because of their similarities in biological functions with vitamins and distribution of foods. So they are called as vitamin-like substances, and as they are synthesized in the body, there is no requirement of them to be supplied through the diet. So here we have to understand about four important compounds. One is choline, lipoic acid, inositol, and para-aminobenzoic acid. So let us understand one by one. So coming to first, that is choline. So this is essential nutrient for animals as well as microorganisms. It cannot say that those microorganisms who cannot synthesize it in adequate quantities to satisfy the requirements. These scientists, Best and Hunstman, in 1934 discovered that choline deficiency in rats produces fatty liver, and this was first time observed. Then it was found that it has got some important role in the formation of fatty liver. That means it is related to metabolism. So then it was found that it is going to have active role in transmethylation reactions. This choline is synthesized in the body, and therefore it is not a vitamin, but in view of its nutrition, conventionally it is included in the member of B complex family. So this is the structure of your choline. So it is a chemically hydroxyethyl trimethyl amine or trimethyl ethanolamine. So it is obtained from the this serine or betaine. There are two sources of synthesis of choline. One is serine amino acid, another is betaine. So serine on decarboxylation forms ethanolamine, and addition of 3 methyl groups to ethanolamine forms choline. So the structure without methyl groups, so there is addition of these 3 methyl groups. Before that, whatever structure you have is the ethanolamine. This will be NH2. So this will be called as ethanolamine. Methylated ethylamine is this. Trimethylethylamine, ethanolamine is choline, and it is found to be the best sources of this can be rice polishings, vegetables, and cereals from animal plant kingdom. And animal sources are Milk, egg and liver are the good sources of this vitamin choline. Now this choline, let us understand what is its importance in the body. It acts as a lipotropic factor. So the lipotropic factors are, what is the definition? You can recall, you have come across this in chemistry of lipids. Lipotropic factors, yes or no? Or I think metabolism of lipids, then you will be trying to understand. That time you will come to know about the lipotropic factors. So these lipotropic factors, they will prevent the formation of fatty liver and cirrhosis. Now how the choline helps in prevention of fatty liver can be explained by its role in the formation of phospholipids. Try to understand, choline is involved in formation of the phospholipids. Now these phospholipids are necessary for the formation of VLDL, that is very low density lipoprotein. Now the role of important role of this VLDL is, this helps in transport of triglycerides from liver to peripheral tissues. That means it scavenges, or you can takes the triglycerides from liver to peripheral tissues, and thus it helps in the prevention of fatty liver formation. That is why what was the discovery by these scientists, that choline deficiency is going to cause the fatty liver. It is mainly because it is not going to be taken from liver to periphery in the form of VLDL, and that is why it will be going to cause the fatty liver. And those substances which prevent the formation of fatty liver, they are called as a lipotropic factor. This is the understanding of the term lipotropic. That is, they will prevent the formation of fatty liver. One of them is choline. There are many substances that that act like lipotropic factors. One of them is choline. So as it helps in preventing the fatty liver, this choline is called as lipotropic factor. So it prevents fatty liver formation. If fatty liver is not treated, it may lead to liver cirrhosis also. So this is the important role of choline. It helps in prevention of lipotropic factor. It helps in prevention of fatty liver by acting as lipotropic factor. Next, this choline has got role in the formation of the membranes. So this membrane structure you have already learned. You have seen what is the composition of the membranes. There are proteins, there are lipid residues. So this phosphatidyl choline is present in the membrane structure of all the cells, and thus choline is a part of the phospholipids of all these. So this phosphatidyl choline is the phospholipid containing choline, so which are seen in the membranes of the all cell. So this choline forms a phosphatidyl choline, and that is obtained by phosphatidyl ethanolamine. So in this way it is going to help in maintenance of the cell membrane structure. Next, it helps in phospholipid synthesis in the myelin sheath. So this myelin sheath is completely made up of phospholipids. So this is, choline is necessary for formation of the phospholipids, and ultimately it is involved in formation of the myelin sheath. So these are the important actions. Next important role of this choline can be, it is going to donate the methyl groups to one carbon pool, and choline is indirectly required for the formation of methionine, and that two form of methionine, that is SAM, S-adenosylmethionine. This major methyl group in the methylation reaction is SAM. So this SAM is indirectly formed from choline. So that we have to remember, it has got role in transmethylation reactions via SAM. So deficiency of choline affects one carbon metabolism and transmethylation reaction. Now you will be knowing all these things, and this you have to recall or you can correlate while understanding the amino acid metabolism and the reactions involved in the amino acid metabolism. So these points you are going to learn in your future classes of amino acid metabolism. There you have to remember all these things. So transmethylation reactions require choline, or choline has got role in transmethylation. What is one carbon pool? What is SAM? What is transmethylation? All the points will be more clear when you understand amino acid metabolism. Here we are trying to understand the role of choline. So it is involved in act as a lactotropic component of cell membrane, phospholipid synthesis, necessary for transmethylation reaction. How and what you will be learning later. Another important role of this choline is in the acetylcholine synthesis. So this acetylcholine is a neurotransmitter. So choline will be necessary for the synthesis of the neurotransmitter, that is acetylcholine. So by the enzyme choline acetylase. So this acetylcholine is broken again back by choline to acetate, and that is by acetylcholine esterases. So both of reactions are important in the nerve transmission of the nerve impulses. Now this acetylcholine, in the form of acetylcholine, it is very important in nerve impulse transmission. So now how it is doing this, or the role of acetylcholine, we should understand. So this acetylcholine transmits the nerve impulse from the presynaptic region to postsynaptic region of the nerve. Now in this you have to understand, the first step is the acetylcholine is synthesized in the presynaptic region. So this is the first step, conversion of acetyl, formation of acetylcholine. So from choline there is formation of acetylcholine by this donation of acetyl group from the acetyl-CoA, and the enzyme is acetylcholine synthase. So first this is, or choline acetylase, add acetyl moiety to choline. Now this acetylcholine in the synaptic vesicle, it attaches to the receptor on synaptic cell. So here it is going to attach. Now this is brought to this receptor in the postsynaptic cell, and this acetylcholine is hydrolyzed by acetylcholine esterase in the synaptic cleft. So this enzyme is here, acetylcholine esterase. Now this acetylcholine is hydrolyzed by acetylcholine esterase, and again you will get choline and acetate is released, and this is going to be again utilized for the formation of acetylcholine. So all these things are going on continuously. So thus acetylcholine transmits the nerve impulse from presynaptic region to post synaptic region of the nerve. So this is the presynaptic region and this is the postsynaptic region. So this is through the mediator called as acetylcholine, and this acetylcholine is obtained from choline in presence of acetyl-CoA. It will be converted into acetylcholine, and then it has got role in the nerve impulse transmission. So the postsynaptic receptors for acetylcholine may be competitively blocked by succinyl-CoA, the structural analog of acetylcholine, and they cannot act producing the muscle relaxants, and hence it is commonly used as a muscle relaxant during surgery. Cholinesterase inhibitors will allow prolonged action of acetylcholine, and therefore nerve impulse is sustained, and the drugs used in myasthenia gravis, that is an autoimmune condition, Antibodies are produced against these neuromuscular end-plate proteins, destroying the end-plates. So they are used, neostigmine is used in the myasthenia gravis. Pseudochlorine esterase is seen in RBCs, more in immature cell. So these are the important points related to the role of choline in the form of acetylcholine in the nerve impulse transmission and the therapeutic aspects related to that. So the choline, the vitamin-like substance that is choline. Next is inositol. So this inositol is a hydroxycyclohexane, and the isomer of this, there are many isomers, that is myo-inositol, is found to be seen in many tissues, and it is known as vitamin B8. Now this is being called as B8, and the important form of this inositol is myo-inositol. So this a chemical structure resembles like a sugar alcohol. So it is hexahydroxycyclohexane. Inositol is a carbohydrate resembling glucose closely in the structure. So you can see its structure here. So this has got, it is having these OH groups and with the six-membered ring, and hence it is hexahydroxycyclohexane. All these hydroxyl groups are there. So it is a sugar alcohol, and it is obtained in muscle, brain, erythrocyte and retina. Plant sources are fruit, vegetable, whole grains, and is this deficiency, it is unknown, and hence it is not being included in the group of vitamins, but it is called as vitamin like substance because it has got wide range of role in various biochemical functions. So the recent studies have shown that inositol is required for the growth of fibroblasts. It is a constituent of phospholipids. It occurs in large quantities in mammalian heart muscles. Phosphatidyl inositol is an important constituent of cell membranes. In response to extracellular signals, inositol triphosphate IP3 is released, and from released from phosphatidyl inositol, and IP3 is acting as a second messenger. So in the signal transduction, you will come across the role of this inositol triphosphate. So this may allow calcium inflow into the cells, leading to cellular metabolic activation. So during signal transduction, you can explore the role of inositol triphosphate as a second messenger. It is important in the peripheral neuropathy, which is mainly very commonly seen in diabetes, and it is mainly associated with inositol metabolism. Decreased inositol in nerve fibers leads to the neuropathy in diabetic patients. Again, like choline, this inositol also acts as a lipotropic factor and helps in prevention of fatty liver. Now, there are some aspects related to inositol. There is a compound called as phytic acid. So this hexaphosphate derivative of inositol is called as phytic acid. It is mainly found in vegetables, and it is not absorbed in the body due to low activity of the phytase enzyme in human beings. So the absorption from intestine of calcium and iron is interfered by presence of high amounts of phytic acid in the diet. Try to understand, the hexaphosphate derivative of inositol is called as phytic acid, and this phytic acid is found in vegetables and not absorbed due to we have less activity of phytase enzyme. So the absorption, this phytic acid will reduce the absorption of these important elements, calcium, iron and magnesium, is interfered by the presence of high amounts of phytic acid. So the poor absorption of calcium and other elements is due to formation of, it mainly forms the insoluble calcium and magnesium salts of phytic acid. So this phytic acid will bind to these elements and they will form the salts, and that will impair the absorption of these important elements in the body. So decreased inositol in nerve fibers can cause peripheral neuropathy in the, because of its lack, it will cause the neuropathy body. So this is the about inositol. So we are seeing choline, inositol. Next is one more important point is about lipoic acid, another compound, and next is the para-aminobenzoic acid. So this para-aminobenzoic acid, it is not a B complex vitamin, but it is closely associated with B complex vitamins. Like B complex vitamin, this PABA is water soluble. However, it is unique in that it is a vitamin within vitamin. That means it is an integral part of folic acid. You have to recall the structure of folic acid, which is having para-aminobenzoic acid as a whole structure of folic acid has got this PABA. So although the structural unit of folic acid is not considered as vitamin, it is an organic compound with the formula like this. It is a white solid, commercial samples can appear gray, highly soluble in water. It consists of benzene ring substituted with amino acid and carboxylic groups. Compound occurs extensively in the nature. The role of this PABA, it is important for growth of several types of microorganisms, and dietary requirement biovertebrates has not been seen. Sulfa drugs, especially which are used as an antibiotics, the sulfonylamides contain para-aminobenzene sulfonylamides, acts as a structural analog of PABA, and this PABA is synthesized by the bacteria, which is essential for the growth. So antibacterial activity of sulfonamides is due to their ability to interfere with the conversion of PABA to folic acid by the enzyme diuretic synthetase. So thus bacterial growth is limited through folate deficiency. So the mechanism of action of these sulfa drugs is by interference of this PABA, which is necessary for the synthesis of folic acid, and that is hampered, and thus it will decrease the proliferation of the bacterial growths. So that is what is, we can restrict the bacterial growth through folate deficiency, because we have seen the role of folate in the formation of the nucleotides and all necessary for the cell proliferation. So sulfa drugs mainly act through acting as an antagonist for that will hamper the folate synthesis. So with this I have completed all these small aspect, that is lipoic acid, you can read from the text. So it is important to do it right now, because later will never, it becomes never. So try, you have to act. Read this, allow your passion to become your purpose, and it will one day become your profession. So all of you have to start working with the passion towards your, the profession that you have chosen. So with this, I come to the end of today's class. Next concluding class of vitamins, we will be discussing about vitamin C, and if possible I will post the case related to vitamins either earlier or on the day of the class itself. So hope to see you in campus at the earliest. Okay, so thank you for today's class.
Thank you, ma'am.
All of you are preparing.
Thank you, ma'am.
Have you started preparations to come in the campus?
Yes.
What is the situation? Hello.